So back here for Telly Talk with Millie Payne. Welcome back, Millie.
Thank you.
Made in Chelsea, then. We're going to start off with that reviewing the TV. Obviously, we watched it last night. It was brilliant, wasn't it, I thought? It's always worth a watch, Made in Chelsea. Just the way that they're really spiteful to each other as well.
Yeah.
So, like, you know.
I didn't know what to expect. I purposely didn't watch any spoilers because I actually like the surprise of what's going to happen. Didn't know whether to expect it to be all, this is nice, first episode back, but of course still lots of drama, which I think is probably what entertains most people who watch.
Yeah, and maybe we should set the scene a bit. So it's in a house, isn't it? So they're all in the house. So that's how they get past the social distancing. They just record it in one house. Everyone's had a COVID test and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And then battle begins. I mean, it's obvious that some of these conflicts are going to happen. Maybe let's just go through some of the what's been going on. We've got people speaking in French to each other, trying to, you know.
Yeah, I think.
Maybe start off on that.
I think that, do you know what? I wondered how they were going to do it this series. And obviously they're all in a house in, like you said, in the Cotswolds, which I think straight away, they're all under the same roof. Of course, there's going to be drama. The scene that you just referred to where they kept talking in French, obviously their exes. And Maeve's current boyfriend is in the house, getting very jealous, thinks they're purposely talking in French to, like, make him feel uncomfortable. But obviously,
they
French
kind
is
of are, aren't they? I mean, there's a bit of it. There's a bit in that, isn't
it? Yeah, and she, how it ends. I mean, I find her hilarious because I don't know if it's her accent when she gets angry. And there was obviously a snippet of the next episode where she's so angry she ends up spitting and getting really angry. But I find, when she gets angry, I find it really comical, which probably, just because, I don't know if it's the accent, I think it is the accent, and she just gets so fiery and so angry, I just love it.
But do you think that Maeve actually likes, do you think she's actually kind of got her attention focused elsewhere?
I'm not too sure, because you've got some people saying that Miles still likes Maeve, and then other people are saying that Maeve still likes Miles, and then you've got poor James, who's just stood there a bit lost. So I don't know. I think it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. Obviously, she wants to go on a walk with him, and that didn't go down well. And I can't remember what the one-liner was, but he said, "Oh yeah, you go for a walk in the park and the rose bushes." Just obviously being really sarcastic. But I think she's very fiery, so she won't stand down. But equally, I understand why he's frustrated. They're all in a house. That's her ex, who she was with. They're speaking in French with each other. She wants to go on a walk with him. So I'm very excited to see how that pans out.
I mean, it's never going to work well when you're all in the house and the ex is on the scene. I mean, it's just a recipe for disaster, really. I know that that's the way that the, you know, Channel 4, obviously we should say it's on More 4.
Yeah.
I don't know why it's not on Channel 4, by the way, but we'll come to that
later.
I mean, it's all set up for conflict, really, isn't it? That's why we like it, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it would be boring without the conflict.
Yeah.
But there's always something going on with the friend, like with whether it's like with the exes, with the friendship group. There's always drama, and I think that is definitely what makes me want to tune in every single week.
Yeah.
But I think the kind of environment as well. Obviously, it's really weird times. Usually they'd probably be doing their separate things in different restaurants and different bars and fancy holidays, but obviously the circumstances mean they're all forced under the same roof, which you can already see the tension starting to show. It all started as, this is going to be so much fun, can't wait to see everyone, and I'm very interested to see what other dramas are going to unfold.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, what about Sam Lenny's, Sam Lenny had a big standoff with Miles, didn't he? I mean, I thought that was going to come to blows, actually.
I think Sam composes himself really well. He's very, how he words things, I can't explain it. I just think he comes across really calm, collected. So even though he's obviously really frustrated, he still stands there, says it how it is. But even when Miles just stormed off, Sam just sort of just stood there as if, I've done my bit. I've sort of said what I needed to. But I think Sam's always so honest, and he looks out for everyone, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And I really like him. But he just sort of comes across like, I'm going to say my bit. I'll still stay really chilled, even though it's getting a bit heated. So I think he did the right thing, because he's just looking out for everyone, isn't he?
Yeah, exactly. What about some of the other characters then? We've got Ollie going into kind of a surrogacy arrangement. We don't know who the other person is, of course, but that was interesting, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I saw that on social media, actually. I don't know how long ago this was filmed. I think a few people seem to think it was quite a while ago, because all the people were like posting stuff on their Instagram. But yeah, I'm because obviously they've, I think I said this in last week's Telly Talk, their lockdown lifestyle has sort of really benefited them. They've gone and got married, now they're considering, like, obviously having a baby. But I think surrogacy is always, I mean, when it's played out in the soaps and stuff, it's always quite a controversial topic, especially for the who's bearing the child, like, what rights do they have to the baby? But I think if they're happy and it all works out, that's great. It's just, it's obviously always it must be quite a tough, like, concept to think about.
Yeah, exactly. And I guess the way that they spoke about it, Ollie and his husband, because obviously they got married last season, the way they talk about it, it seems a bit more simple than what it probably is in practice.
Yeah. And I think for them as well, probably Ollie more so, I got the vibe that he wanted that big, spectacular wedding. But obviously, they've now had that, and they're probably looking forward to the next step. It's just, obviously, for them, it's going to be, I guess it's as well, like, how do you, this is just me being like, no, how do you choose that right person to bear your future child? And there's so much to think about. So yeah, I mean, hats off to them for taking that decision. I just think it's very, it must be quite a lot to think about.
Yeah, exactly. What about some of the other kind of storylines then there? I mean, what did you enjoy about it? Because obviously this is the first episode of the season, isn't it?
Yeah.
So lots to look forward to. What else caught your eye?
I'm a big fan of Tristan and Liv, actually. I've remembered her name this week.
Yeah.
I love how fiery she is. So it's...
She's not backwards and coming forwards.
No. She's very, very upfront. And obviously she's pulled Julia straight away on the things that he was saying behind.
That was so awkward.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
And she got the phone out, and you could see how viciously she was scrolling. I really like her because I was about to say her character, but it's actually her. I really like how fiery she is because she stands up for what she believes in. She doesn't take any rubbish. But the whole scene was just really uncomfortable, and the snippet for next week is obviously you see Julius talking to Tristan, and then you see a snippet where maybe Tristan's not been there for Liv, but you do wonder what happened between Liv and Julius, because there's still, she sort of was, it was implying that she was half denying that they kissed. So I don't know.
Yeah, Julius, my wife Angie was watching it, and she doesn't like Julius. She says he's a bit awkward, or is that the right word?
I'm still making my mind up on him. I think I'm really weird. I either warm to a character straight away, don't warm to a character, and there's those ones in the middle that I'm like, I need a few more episodes to sort of gauge how I feel. It will be interesting to see if he takes advantage of Liv and Tristan arguing to see whether he uses that to his advantage. But obviously you've got Miles, who sort of also is trying to do things for his own advantage as well, I think. So it's going to be, I'm excited to see what happens.
Yeah, exactly. Let's talk about the talk show then that Sam's now got. And it's, I don't know, you've seen it advertised, haven't you? It's a bit bizarre. I mean, some of the characters appear in it as well. It comes on at midnight, so I'd finishing off an essay, so it just happened to come on. But a lot of them have these spin-off activities, don't they? Sam being one of them. We've had Hugo, who was in some of the first episodes. He's not in it now. Well, there's been Hugo, but there's also been other characters that are kind of doing advertising as well, appearing on adverts. So
I know, I think Spencer and Jamie should do a podcast. And I think Jamie particularly, I see on his social media, his podcast is to really address, like, real life issues such as like social anxiety, like men's mental health. So I think that's great that he's using his platform in that way. And obviously Sam is really good friends with Pete Wicks from TOWIE, which I love their friendship. They're both
and
quite
I think he's
different.
On this programme. And it's quite funny because you've got Sam kind of acting quite in a suit, trying to act posh.
And then you've obviously got
big contrast there.
Yeah.
So it kind of works pretty well, yeah.
I think it does. I think a lot of them are using their platforms in a positive way, especially in the lockdown. Like, I know Sam, he's constantly, like, playing tricks on his sister, and he'll post the videos, and he just really makes me laugh. I love how he uses his platform in such a positive, light-hearted way. Yeah. But then Pete is quite... On TOWIE, Pete comes across like quite a serious character, so I wonder if their friendships complement each other, like their personalities complement each other, and they meet in the middle. So I love how a lot of them use their platforms, particularly Jamie, like I said, with like the social media like looking at anxiety and things like that. So I think that's really good.
So with Pete and Jamie then, I mean, what, there's a contrast there. I mean, do you prefer Towie to Maiden Chelsea? Because I know you watch, but I don't really watch Towie. But looking at Pete on there, there is this contrast between the two.
I wouldn't even know where to start in trying to say which one I prefer. I love them both for probably quite similar reasons in terms of watching their lives unfold and becoming quite embarrassingly like invested in them. But I think, so on Pete on Towie, he's quite he's become quite like closed off. It's quite known that he's not really willing to try and have relationships with anyone. We don't know if like he's gone through his own, like he's battling something. But whereas obviously you look at Sam, and he's not saying Pete's not, but Sam comes across like this really lovable character. And I think that's when I mean they probably complement each other and meet in the middle.
All right, we'll catch up in the second half. Going to be discussing Line of Duty and other programmes. Join us then. So back here for Telly Talk with Millie Payne, second half, going into crime now, aren't we, from Maiden Chelsea to crime. just a quick one on Line of Duty. How was that for you this week, the latest episode?
Oh, it's really, really getting good. I always feel like the first episode is, it's always gripping, but it sort of sets the scene. And then the second one, incredible. Again, obviously, I can't come on here and give anything away. But if you haven't watched it, watch it. I really want you to. So I think because you would just love it. But yeah, very, very good.
Yeah.
There's a few, I don't know whether it's a blessing or a curse, actually. Because I go on the hashtag after Line of Duty on Twitter, and so many people are like spotting little clues about things, and I don't know whether I'd rather know or not know. Like people are like zooming into the computers and being able to see what like they're looking at, as if to give us little hints. But I'm like, I'm not that observant, so I'd kind of rather not know.
Does it make you question the police? Do you think they're that corrupt or not? When you're watching it, how's it reflect on the police? Because I'm saying this because obviously we're going to go into White House Farm, which has now been put on Netflix, and obviously there's a lot of police botching up an investigation. But what about Line of Duty? Does it make you question the police, their motives, or at least some of them? Because we've got a national debate about that at the moment, haven't we?
Yeah, it does. I sound pathetic. So it does scare me a little bit. I know it's obviously fiction. And then you think, hang on, though, there are actual police officers like out there at the moment that are trying to catch those other police officers that perhaps aren't doing their job to the standard they should be. And you think, hang on, but these people aren't the ones that are supposed to keep us safe and protect the public. So it does, I know my housemate, she was like, I didn't want to watch Line of Duty for ages because I thought it would really like scare me and like shake me up a little bit. But it's interesting you linked it with White House Farm, because as I was watching, again, it always does come back to these like illegitimate police officers that perhaps are not got their heart in the right place.
Yeah, exactly. So that's Line of Duty. White House Farm, now this was on last year. A friend of mine was an extra in it as well. And we should say it's about, it's more than one murder, it's about four murders, wasn't it? Jeremy Bamber, who's obviously still in prison, got a whole life term for that. I think he's got various appeals going through, but some of which have already been rejected. But it's well made, wasn't it, White House Farm, I thought?
It was. I was just saying to you before we came on, I hate saying, especially because it was based on a true story, I hate saying I enjoyed it, because that sounds really, like, quite messed up. But the way the drama was played out, I thought was absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
Like, I had to keep reminding myself that it was based on a true story, because that makes it even more gripping, I think. I couldn't wait to watch the next episode and then the next episode. I really thought the acting was fantastic, and I always know the sign of a good actor is when you absolutely despise the character. And Jeremy from the first episode, I thought, no, there's just something not quite right. But I thought it was incredible. Definitely would recommend the watch.
Yeah, I mean, and obviously with White House Farm, there's the police come under the microscope again, because obviously there was a lot of missed opportunities there, wasn't there? There was kind of all sorts of things, windows like being half open, and you know, kind of bits of guns being left in cupboards but not found. And I mean, you can see why the whole case there has been questioned. It's and obviously, you know, nearly got away with it, didn't he? Obviously he got convicted a long time ago now, but nearly got away with it. And as you say, Stan, who's a detective there, had to kind of convince his superiors to kind of change their mind. The police just wanted to kind of, you know, come to a conclusion. And it was weird, wasn't it? It was kind of, they had a kind of an idea in their mind, and then despite overwhelming evidence, still stuck with that same line.
Yeah, that's
and it was a cost thing as well, wasn't it?
It was.
Yeah.
Because the
chief constable said it's a cost thing, we can't spend any more money on it.
And he used to get so angry if there was ever an alternative narrative to what they'd said about Sheila, like, killing herself. And that's what got me, is that I was such a Stan fan. I would be like, yes, keep going, you need to keep fighting for this. And and you could see how much he wanted justice for that family. Well, obviously for Colin as well, the poor guy who was left without, like, the mother of his children and, like, his in-laws. But I just think it was the way that chief constable just wanted it done. And yet the scene that I loved is when Chief Constable said, right, okay, got all the police officers together and said, who do you think did this crime? And they all said Jeremy, and obviously then he got taken off of the case. But it really upset me that Stan didn't get the recognition in real life. The detective didn't get the recognition he deserved because of his work. That's the reason Jeremy got convicted. I mean, he was just a strange, strange guy. Some of the scenes where you just think, oh, and obviously, Julie, his girlfriend, ex-girlfriend, did the right thing by going forward. But you think she sat on that for a month, didn't she? That's still a bit messed up in itself. But I think she was just scared.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it was quite gripping as well. If you didn't know the story, I mean, obviously, I don't remember. I doubt you would remember it.
No.
You're a lot younger than me. So, if you weren't there at the time, it was or you don't remember it, then it's an interesting drama to follow. And it really, as you say, kind of really follows the case very closely. Obviously, I think it's obviously had to be pretty factually correct, and it was well made. Just before we finish up then, I mean, what else is catching your eye over the next few weeks?
The Circle will still be catching my eye. So that's a very social media programme on Channel 4.
Yeah.
That's very much like Your Love Island, where it's kind of on every night and you sort of get really addicted to the characters. And I say characters, they're real people. But yeah, so that is something I've got my eye on. I know you keep telling me about The Spy, so I'm going to definitely check that out.
Yeah.
And I really do want to watch the whole series of Unforgotten, because my granddad just got an extra part in that. But I haven't watched the first three series to be able to watch.
And what's that about, Unforgotten?
So again, I think it's very much like your classic six-parter ITV drama, mystery, murder, that kind of thing. But I felt really guilty because my mum and dad would be saying, like, oh, we watch him waiting for granddad's appearance. But I haven't watched the other series yet, so that is what I really want to watch. I'm trying to think.
You ever watched The Serpent? Because that's one thing that I want to go back to. Hopefully BBC keep it on iPlayer, which they're pretty good at doing that now.
Is it quite messed up?
Well, I know it's difficult to follow. That's what I've been told. Because there's flashbacks, a lot of use of flashbacks. I haven't seen any of it, but I've been told that there's lots of flashbacks. So I think you need to have a clear head.
Yeah.
And kind of know a bit about the story. But that seems pretty good. That's one that I want to go back and watch when I've got time. It's a Serpent. Keep meaning to do that.
I have heard a lot of good things about it. I mean, another one that I did watch, I think, was it two or three episodes of, was Killing Eve. And everyone raves about it.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether to give it another go, but I just watched a few episodes and I thought, this is really not a bit of me at all.
Yeah.
But I know that is coming back for its final season. Honestly, in the same way, I know social media doesn't reflect everyone's opinions, but I seem to be in the minority that couldn't really get into it, but my mum loves that, so that might have to be another one. I sit down, everything away, and just completely focus and see if I can get into it.
That's the one in America, and I know that Barack Obama put it on his kind of list of things to watch as well, so I know it's done well.
Yeah.
I think it might even be on Netflix, I'm not sure. But
I'm not too sure either, actually.
Yeah, I have noticed on Netflix, by the way, that they've put up a lot of programme. There's just so much more on it now. It's incredible, isn't it? I mean, you literally could spend your whole life watching TV.
Yeah.
Some people think we actually do that.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, just should add that I do have a life outside of it. Hopefully I will when lockdown eases a little bit.
Yeah, we've got that coming up then. And then what's in the summer? Any more news on kind of new releases on terrestrial TV coming up?
Do you know what? When I've looked online, it seems very much like a lot of the dates are either like haven't been confirmed, or it goes up to I think when I looked and came on last week, it had gone up to May, but nothing past then, really. I mean, in terms of films, I guess we're still waiting for this James Bond film. I wonder when. I think that's it, is now October.
Yeah.
But I also guess with a lot of series, I, depends on when they started filming, whether it was when lockdown was slightly eased. I guess they have to take into consideration all of these restrictions. So hopefully it will be a good season of Telly.
And
I'm sure
I think
it will be.
The Bond film, I mean, personally, I think they should release that for when the cinemas open up, because I think that would definitely get, you know, people into cinemas more than anything else, because it is one big kind of blockbuster movie that definitely gets people want to see a Bond film in a cinema, including me. So that I would rather wait and see that at the cinema than actually watch it on pay-per-view.
It's just one of those you do want to go and see it on the big screen, don't you? That's and it's the whole cinema experience. You love it. If you feel like it's escapism, you're in that theatre and everything is just, all that matters is that film. Whereas I do kind of get that watching it at home, but it's just not the same experience, because, I mean, it's not escapism in your home at the moment, because that's where we are all the time. So, yeah, I think definitely that'll be a good, hopefully, when cinemas reopen. But I did read somewhere, I think it won't be till later this year. So.
Right. And what about, before we finish up, soaps? I mean, I've given up on the soaps. Does anyone still watch EastEnders, Coronation Street on Emma Dale on a regular basis?
Yeah, I used to a lot, and now I've sort of given up. Yeah. I think I used to be a massive Corrie fan, and my mum sometimes still has it on if I come back from, like, when I go home. And I watch it, and I think this is just... Maybe it's because I'm not following it. I'm like, I find it so depressing. And I'm like, some of the acting now, I'm like, it's quite cringeworthy. But I used to love Coronation Street. I used to be an avid watcher. But now I find them, one, you need a lot of commitment if you're going to watch it every day. And two, I would rather put
what
my...
What about Hollyoaks? Because Hollyoaks has been going for a while now. And it started, back in the 90s? I remember, I think, when it's been going for a long, long, long time.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to leave it there.
Thanks
for coming in, Millie, and we'll catch up again soon. Take care.
See you later.
Thanks.